Good afternoon. Thank you all for not sticking it out at the food kramen over there. So actually, the official title had something like AI is evil, yeah, or makes your apps evil. And you know what, to hear all these stories, you've got on one hand, you've got all these futurists like Stephen Hawking and others that say AI will ruin our world. And then on the other hand, you've got all these big technology companies today that are saying, oh, we all know about AI and machine learning, and we're going to build all these magnificent applications for you. I think both of them are just total nonsense. Yeah? This whole AI stuff is basically based on two big pillars. One of them is machine learning, the other one is natural language processing, and they are just computer science. Yeah? That's all. It's just computer science, a few algorithms, some data. That's all there is to it. So my goal for you today is that you will walk away here, and whenever you talk to someone who just has a little bit of digital knowledge, that you will be able to explain to them what machine learning is and how it could help them. Or if you're application builders or system builders, how you can integrate machine learning into the systems that you build and make them much smarter than that they were. Yeah, so everything is centered around data in our world. Remember, all the algorithms that you can make of this world don't really matter anything if it isn't working on data. And whether that is your backends or whether your analytics or all these kind of things. And in my eyes, especially if you think about data processing, there's sort of three big different pillars there. One of them is sort of like past, now, future. Past, present, future. Yeah? In the past, it is really sort of the traditional business intelligence, taking data in that you've collected and then writing reports about the past, sort of business intelligence. Data warehousing, things like that. And then the second pillar is now. This one's really on the rise because you're no longer interested in what was your inventory level yesterday. You want to know what it is right now. You're not interested in how your customers are talking about you yesterday. You want to know what they're saying about you right now so you can react right now. And so the third pillar is the future. Yeah? How can I make predictions? And that seems like sort of magic, you know, a crystal ball or, you know, some dark room and you have to pay a lot of money to get in there and they will tell you the future. Actually, the easiest way to predict the future is to use data from the past. Yeah, so that means that those predictions will not be perfect, but predictions are never perfect because they talk about the future as something that hasn't happened yet. So the best way to approach that is to look at the past and say, what can I do from data that I had from the past to make predictions about the future? And that's actually all that machine learning is. Yeah? So we call these things machine learning because they look at your data, try to find patterns, right? And then use that to sort of help you make predictions about the future. Yeah, so those two things together, the data that you have and these machine learning algorithms together, they together allow you to build smarter applications. And so there's so many different applications, so many different of this. You know, if you know things about your customer, can you predict what they will like about your product? If you get an order and you have some history about orders, can you make a prediction whether this is a fraudulent order or not? And if you like this particular news article, is that something that you can then serve your customers with similar news articles that they also might like? All of this stuff that you are already used to on a daily basis is all machine learning. And so within Amazon, the retailer, we've been doing this for more than 20 years now. And it is pervasive for anything that we do in the company. Yeah? Whether it's your recommendations, or whether it's inventory level setting, or you know, classification of books, all these kind of things, automatic browse note generation, all of that is machine learning. Yeah? Now, if we can do it, you can do it. Yeah? And so one particular area that you as a consumer are very well aware of is sort of the world of personalization. Yeah? So on one hand, there's something that we call similarities. That is basically item-to-item relationships. Yeah? People that bought this particular item also bought that one. These two are more frequently bought together. And then you have recommendations, which are item-to-consumer. Yeah, where you make really personalized recommendations, or you make use of sort of the generalized knowledge of the overall system, we talk about bestsellers and things that actually go well together, if there are bestsellers, all of these things, again, machine learning. By the way, let me take one step outside of the actual talk, because I think this is interesting. Why is personalization so important? Yeah, this is a story from a long time ago already, that if you increase choice, people become much more unhappier with the things that they choose. Yeah, it's sort of the paradox of choice is what it's called. Yeah, and so if you have only three toothpastes to choose from, you pick one that you want, you're probably happy with your choice. If suddenly there's 50 toothpastes there, you get confused. Yeah, suddenly you need to make a choice. And you make a choice, but the thing, but the fact that you, the notion that you have, that you, did I really choose the right one? Could I have chosen a better one? Yeah, and that's actually a big driver for unhappiness. Yeah, and so the more choices you have, the less likely it is that you are to choose. And the more choices you have, the more unhappy you will be with your choice. That might actually have been exactly the same choice when you only had three choices. Now, these things in regular grocery stores are important, but online it's even more important because you don't have 50 toothpastes with 5,000. Yeah, so how can we help you become happier with your choice? And so, you know, personalization, which is all driven by machine learning, helps to reduce the choices that you get, with then helping you be more happier about the choices that you make. Now let's go back to machine learning. So how do we think, so one area where machine learning helps is sort of predicting how customers will react to offers that you make. So let's see how we used to do this. Yeah, sorry, some SQL statements, you don't need to look at it, it's just an example of how bad this stuff actually works in the past. Yeah, so you would say, oh, you know, I want to send this offer to everybody that has placed an order in the last 30 days. Well, you don't want to do that at Amazon, because then you have to send out hundreds of millions of emails. Doesn't work that way, yeah? So those who bought toys, oh wait, those who bought toys and helicopters, but that excludes quadcopters, yeah? So you, again, you start refining this SQL query that you're making over your database, and what you're doing, you're just guessing. You're just guessing how to target the right set of customers that might be interested sort of in this, in the offer that you have to make. And this is how we used to do things. But it was just, and it was mostly done on intuition. And so the results of that are just nonsense. Yeah? Because it could be much better. Because you have already a lot of knowledge about your customers. You know how they've reacted to offers in the past. And so can you make use of that information that you have from the past to automatically learn about who would be interested in this particular offer that you have? So that's called machine learning. So let's look at this, and as I told you, this is gonna be a really practical talk. Yeah? Just an Excel sheet. Yeah, this is sort of a database of a database of emails that you've sent, and the row and column in that, that's really important, is the one, did they click the email that you send them or not? You have this information. Right? You already know this. So this is the information you have about the past. Now, you're going to use that data as what's called training data. Right? This is the data that you're going to use to make predictions about the future. So the training data goes into a training system where you're going to try to refine it and figure out exactly how to use the data, which kind of information from that data is sort of can be relevant, can allow you to make these predictions really well. And then that goes into what's called in machine learning terms a model. This is sort of the holy grail where you end up with. And those things are often called models or predictors or classifiers. Those are different names that you will see there. And then you have this set of what you call input data. These are customers that you would like to send this email to. And what you're then going to do is you're going to put that data into the model. Yeah? And then the model is going to make predictions about which of those customers are most likely to actually open the email. Now, yeah, and then you end up with a data set there again, which says, now, you might as well not send the email to that set of customers because they're not going to open the email. Yeah? These are not the ones that you want to target. And so it's actually not really a binary one. It's not yes or no. Yeah? It is really a sort of a number between somewhere 0 or 1. And depending on the threshold that you choose, this becomes yes or no. In this case, it looks like 0.9 has been the threshold, but imagine you would lower that to 0.7, you get a lot more yeses. So picking the threshold here, it becomes really important. There's a lot of support that you need there as well. So that's sort of the basic things that machine learning does. It takes data from the past, it uses a bunch of algorithms, and then it's going to make predictions from knowledge about the past, and it's not just who clicked the email, but what kind of other attributes do they have? What's their purchasing history? What's their interest? Things like that. What are the commonality between the people that actually did click that email beyond the fact that they just clicked the email? And use that data to then make predictions. And so that's a typical one. So what other things can you do there? Yeah, so for example, you get orders in. And if you have a long history about customers that have used your system, you can make a sort of prediction about, is this a fraudulent order or not? And that's called a binary classifier. A real good binary classifier, for example, is try to predict the gender of a customer. That's a hard thing up first, and definitely doing it based on names is probably not going to work very well for you. This is not going to be, if you just pick those two attributes, you're going to have a hard time predicting whether someone is female or male. Demand forecasting, that's not a 0 or 1, that's clearly a number. It's called regression. Those predict real numbers. And this is really sort of demand forecasting, trying to figure out what you should have in stock to make sure that you never run out of stock, but at a minimum level. Textbook classifiers, another classical one. Yeah, there you can actually put things in multiple buckets. Something is and a math book, and it might be a computer science book. Yeah, so again, those things are things that you want to do in an automatic fashion. We get a lot of products in at Amazon that have no classification with them at all. Is this a fiction? Is it non-fiction? Does it fall into crime, or is it true crime? Yeah, so all these kind of things are things that you can learn with using machine learning or determine. It's called the multi-class classifier in this case. Abusive reviews. Something that we don't do, we don't have someone sitting there reading every review. Now, you make use of machine learning to try and figure out whether this is an abusive review or not. And so you can patch these things together as well. Doesn't necessarily need to be only one model. You can have multiple models actually working together. So the thing, of course, is you have to figure out how good is this. And again, that's a really practical approach. You have to figure out, you can do this, it's called validation. You basically use your data from the past to see if you can correctly predict it. So what you do is you take 75% of your original input set, feed that into the model, and then use 25% of the past to see whether you can correctly predict the past. Yeah? And so again, you get an idea then about whether your predictor actually really works. And you can just do this with very high certainty because you already know about the past. Yeah? Can you correctly predict the past? Is actually sort of the test. Yeah, you can figure out accuracy, you can tweak your model again to make sure that it really works, at least for the past. And you can do it 4 times over each part of your data. Again, you put those things in, it's not good enough. You tweak the data, you put more data columns in there, you actually tune the model until a point where you think it is just good enough. And then that final model is something that you're going to use in production. Yeah, you can also have, not necessarily just only binary things connected, but you can have something, for example, that has a binary classifier that selects a group first and then have a regression after that. Turns out, all of this stuff, until now, was pretty hard. Yeah, it is, the technology for it was hard. It's hard to find real good engineers that are capable of doing this. And we had a significant part of our efforts internally to sort of hand code these models, to really figure out, what is the right model to use here. If you look at literature, there are probably 500 or more algorithms that all work on binary classification. And all of those researchers will all claim that their algorithms is the absolute best. We have to figure that one out. So there's a lot of things happening that prevents people from making use of machine learning to just build better applications. So internally, we decided, you know, we have this real service-oriented approach. Can't we just hide all of this complexity from the individuals and the workers in our organization that want to use machine learning? So we did a test. We built, behind the covers, a machine learning service. And we did this test on the same data set. There's a boundary classification. The first group was two very experienced engineers hand-coding it, doing it by hand, and actually reached sort of 92% accuracy after 2 months. There's a lot of work that goes in there. Then we used the servers, yeah, and a junior developer, within 20 minutes, has reached the same level of accuracy. And this is what you can do, because if you can hide much of the complexity of all this machine learning, everybody can make use of it. Because there's lots of standard stuff that just has to happen for everyone, a lot of work that everybody has to do, that you can work, take it away. And so making this a service exploded the complete use within AWS, or within Amazon. Yeah? It's everything from managing sales to counterfeit good detection and to helping customer support. You know, all of these decision trees in customer support or automatic replies to managing, parsing emails and things like that, it's all machine learning. And so, you know, we saw that as a huge opportunity for not just us to make use of machine learning, but also for you. Yeah, and so we built a machine learning service that all of you can use. Yeah, it's exactly the same machine learning service that the engineers within Amazon use to build all of these different areas of machine learning. Yeah, and so it's the same pieces, that simple to use. Yeah, really, and the big cool thing is that you can turn this into a software component that you can integrate into any of your applications. So if you want to make your applications more smart, you can make use of the machine learning service. Yeah, and again, there's in building that, there's three different steps you have to do. First, as I said earlier, you have to build a model. Yeah, and actually that becomes really simple because they give you a visual environment there. Yeah, you take your data sets, you put them in there, and then you start sliding different sliders to figure out what is the kind of bidding strategy I want to use, and things like that. And then you can run tests against it. And then you're going to go through this phase of optimization. Remember, that is where you use data from the past to see how accurate you can be. And again, there's this threshold that you're going to draw, and then you're going to take a look at what are the false positives, what's the accuracy, and all these things you're going to tweak in a visual way until you're happy with it. And then one push of a button, and this turns into a software component that you can integrate into any of your applications. Yeah, if you then get an order in, you just call this software component that actually helps you determine what the likelihood, whether this is a fraudulent order or not. Yeah, it is that simple. You can integrate it into any of the applications that you have. Yeah, so this is sort of the, what shall I say, the working on numbers and character data. But machine learning is being applied in many other different areas that are just as simple for you to use. So let's close this off, this presentation, looking at a few of those. Yeah? For example, you might have a simple question. Yeah? What is the likelihood that this is an urban or a rural area? So taking imaging. Yeah? Or there's a lot of machine learning being used in healthcare. Yeah? Is this a healthy or an unhealthy scan? Yeah? But you can go much deeper. Not just, is this a city or a rural area? Which city is this? By the way, do you know which city it is? It's Hong Kong, yeah. Great, that was an easy one, eh? Okay, but much more harder would be, what type of tumor is this? Yeah, and lots of assistance is given there to radiologists and others, not to replace them, but to actually help them with additional insights into sort of all the patterns that you've seen from the past. Object detection is an easy one. Yeah, that's obviously something that happens a lot, especially take, for example, self-driving cars and things like that. All of them run on machine learning. And actually, this is an easy one. If you want to do that same object in this one, it's a bit harder. Yeah? And so, but still, quite a few machine learning algorithms do really well there on imaging. Yeah, where's the car? Yeah? How do you segment each of the different pieces in this image? Yeah? Or give me the different muscle groups that are in this particular image that are in there. So lots of this machine learning is applied to not only sort of this database style of transactions, but a lot more than just that. And a lot of it is going into video analytics, going into image analytics, things like that. Another area that's being used pervasively is in robotics. Yeah, so in our warehouses now in the US, we've got 30,000 robots running around. Those are those little orange things where our workers no longer need to walk through the warehouse to pick things from the shelf, but they stand in one place and these robots come to you. Yeah, with the shelves on top of them. They bring the shelf to you. Now, how they find their routes throughout the whole warehouse and how to adapt to the other robots going around, again, it's all machine learning. What is the shortest path between here and there is not only dependent by just the straight line, but it might be what are the highways that the other robots are using and what time of the day. We even have a challenge that if you're interested in the robotic side of things, it's called the Amazon Picking Challenge, is where how can you build robots that can detect the different products that are sitting on these shelves and then grab the right one in an automatic fashion. All of that, again, is using imagery to actually detect what the objects are and which ones you have to pick. All of that is machine learning. It might look like magic. It is not. Yeah? As I've shown before, it's just data from the past where you run some algorithms over and then you try to make predictions. Now, the predictions are never perfect, yeah? But you can get as good as close as possible as you want to. So with that, then we have built this machine learning service that you can use. Yeah, and I hope that this has never been a better time to actually start building these kind of applications. Yeah, so even if you're a developer, go check this stuff out. If you're just a digital native, I hope that by now you can walk away and explain machine learning to everybody else in the world. So with that, go build them. Thank you.